Garcia and her team. Also from forestry, Dr. Mauricio, from my FGC, agriculture family, from IPB and from IPS, and our graduate students of MBB and of genetics, microbiology, and some agricultural biotechnology program also. Good afternoon and welcome to SEARCA's Agriculture and Development Seminar Series, or called ABSS. We always see it being projected in their electronic board. ABSS is meant to encourage the presentation and discussion of development and research issues, as well as their implications for agriculture and rural development. Through the ADSS, SEARCA proactively contributes to having a vibrant scientific exchange within and even via the Hispanic science community. This afternoon's seminar is co-organized by SEARCA, the Philippine Genome Center Agriculture Program, which is based here in UPLB, and of the University of the Philippines Hispanics Institute of Agriculture. Our speaker for this afternoon received her BS from the Department of Chemical Engineering of University of the Philippines, Diliman, back in the 1980s, early 1980s. Her MS from the Department of Crop and Soil Science of the University of Georgia in the late, towards 2000 already. And her PhD from the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology at the Mississippi State University, also known as MSU, the other MSU, in early 2000. She is presently a research assistant professor at the Institute for Genomics, Biocomputing, and Biotechnology of Mississippi State University, where she performs research on the genomics and transcriptomics of a range of organisms that are of biological, economic, and agricultural significance to elucidate the biochemical mechanisms and genetic basis of growth, development, disease and progression, pathogen and pest resistance, and host pathogen pest interaction, and to understand genome structure and evolution. Among the subjects of her completed current or future research efforts, it would include the loblolly pine, reniform nematode, Mexican fruit fly, and rice. I'm sure that with her visit now, she'll be having future collaborative research with Erie and probably with UPL. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome, deliver her lecture on the use of genomics in improvement of crops, Dr. Zenaida V. Magbanua, a balik scientist of under the OST.
Thank you, Dr. Love, for that very generous introduction. At this point, I would like to thank my local host, headed by Dr. Love, and everybody who's been with me in the lab in these last few days. They've been really nice, very hospitable, and I really have everything nice to say about them. Okay, so this afternoon, I also thank everybody for coming to this seminar. So I will be talking about the use of genomics in the improvement of crops. So my objective is for you to get familiar with genomics application in agriculture if you're not familiar yet, and hopefully for you to think about using genomics in your area of research, you know, even a small component, or even just a small component, or at least team up with somebody who does genomics, okay? Okay, so let me begin with this slide. What are the problems facing the 21st century? So you can probably add to the list, but this is the list that I came up with. New diseases, or pathogens, all diseases, climate change, which is really global warming, and really, you know, the most pressing to be astronomic population growth, coupled with dwindling world resources. Okay? And we scientists propose that agriculture might be able to help, at least in, you know, these last two concerns, alleviating climate change, and also at the same time maybe helping increase the potential of the world resources that are dwindling right now. Okay, so how do we propose that agriculture will do this? Simply by just increasing yields, lowering inputs, so with chemical inputs, I mean pesticides, fertilizers, and anything similar to that. And then increasing resistance or meaningful resistance against abiotic and biotic stresses. And also obtain sustainability. This is related to lower chemical inputs, so meaning as much as possible, we don't want to put any of these inputs because, you know, it will also decrease the cost related to farming and agriculture, and improve the value added to the crops, okay? And at this point, I would also like to propose that genomics can help. Genomics can help perform all of these suggestions, and I will explain to you why. So first of all, let's define what genomics is. It is just simply the study of the genome, and the genome is the sum total of all heritable sequences in an organism. In most cases, we're talking about the DNA, genetic material, and all of its attributes. Okay? So, traits that are important in agriculture. So, this would be drought resistance, stress resistance, high yield, seed shattering, and all of those, you know, agricultural traits are dictated by genes. Okay? And these genes are annotated from DNA sequences. Okay? So when we say that genomics may be able to provide help in these areas of different areas of agriculture, we're really referring to knowledge of gene sequence. We need to know gene sequence and we need gene sequence information. Okay? So as a review, let's look at what's going on in agriculture right now. Okay, so agriculture has been working to improve our lives all throughout, you know, the beginning of human history. So, and what has been proven to be successful could be traditional breeding, and that because this is how we came up with all these crops that we eat right now. We cultivated rice, maize, wheat, oat, and all of these cereals, and other trees, and other vegetables. So everything underwent through traditional breeding. Okay, but what is the problem with traditional breeding? It is very slow, right? It takes several generations. I mean, depending on your crop, depending on your plant, it normally takes several generations. Okay, and then later on, scientists came up with marker-assisted selection. So now they started using markers, molecular markers. It could be a visible marker if they have something like that, that they use to assist in selection. Okay? But again, there's some problem with it. It's better than traditional breeding, but it does not work all the time. Okay? And then later on, transgenic technology came into place. So, well, transgenic technology is a little bit controversial even until now, but it still is available, and we're able to improve a few crops using this technology. Okay, but the problem is, in order to use transgenic technology, we need to have gene sequences. Okay, because you transfer genes, and so right now we really have a limited knowledge of genes that we're in. we have done RNAi technology. What is RNAi? RNA interference. Okay, and I will discuss that a little bit in a later slide. So, and again, because it's dependent on sequences, gene sequences, it's also, its application is limited because we have a limited knowledge of gene sequence information. Okay? And another area would be optimization of chemical inputs and soil conditions. Okay? So at this point in agriculture, we rely heavily on fertilizers, pesticides, and all of these chemical inputs. Okay, so that's the current state of agriculture. Okay, so on the next few slides, we're going to discuss how these current areas or current researches in agriculture are slowing progress. Why we need to have something that will give us results in a shorter amount of time. Okay, so let's talk about traditional breeding. So when we use traditional breeding, we select 27 traits by crossing and waiting for the progeny to grow and manifest the phenotype. So usually it takes several generations to accomplish what we really like. So I would like to give you an example of this. This is the present day cultivated maize. And this is a deoxyntate. This is the progenitor of the present day maize. And over thousands of years, our ancestors cultivated deoxyntate in order to come up with the present day maize. So it took that long to have cultivated maize. And right now, there are research dealing with deoxyntate and maize that seem to suggest that only a few genes are responsible for this change from this structure into this structure. Okay? And another example of a traditional breeding would be something similar to this. Say, for example, we're breeding for high yield and disease resistance, two characteristics that are desired in agriculture. And for example, we have these tomatoes. This one on the left is disease resistant but low yielding. And this tomato on the right would be disease susceptible but high yielding. So what we have done in the past would be to cross them and select the progeny until such time that we have created disease resistant and high yielding tomatoes just like this. So This procedure would take several generations or years of process, so definitely it will take a long time to come up with something like this using traditional breeding. Okay? And then let's talk about marker assisted selection. So it is just using molecular markers to breed for desirable traits. So right now we have SSRs or simple sequence repeats, RFLPs, AFLPs, and other types of molecular markers. And usually when we use these markers, we are looking at traits that are quantitative, meaning traits or QTLs, quantitative traits. And what are QTLs? These are traits whose expression are not determined by a single gene or locus. So what happens is you have a trait that is affected by several loci whose individual influences will be small or very minimal. Okay, so it is hard to do it by just traditional breeding. You have to do marker assisted selection. And usually what breeders use would be LOD or log of odds. Okay, so by definition, it is just log of the probability that the evidence, the genetic evidence, can explain a phenomena divided by the probability that it is a random event. Okay, so let me give you an example. So if you have a log of zero, it means it's just one divided by one, or one in the numerator is the probability that it can be explained by the genetic event divided the probability that it's due to random test. So if these two values are the same, so a lot of zero is not really a good evidence, right? Yes, okay, thank you. What about a log equal to one? So it means that the probability that it can be explained by the evidence, genetic evidence, divided that by the probability that it's due to randomness, which is 0.1. And this will give us a log value of 1. Still, we don't accept this because we think that this is too big to accept. And the same thing with 2. Usually, if you have a log that's equal to 3, you can accept it. So 3 or above will be a good evidence that can support linkage, meaning that 1 is the probability that it is due to the genetic evidence divided by due to randomness, which is 0.001. Okay, so that's a log of 3. So if you have a LOD of 3 or more, then it is supporting your genetic evidence that it can be linked to the trait. Okay? So this is an example. So on the y-axis, you have LOD values, and on the x, you have a centimorgan or genetic distance. So in this figure, if you focus your search in this area, in this low side, then chances are it is linked to the trait that you're looking for because it has LOD values of 3 or above. Okay? So if you focus on these areas, and these areas correspond to these sequences here and the sequences here, so chances are you may have the locus that are responsible for the traits that you're looking for. Okay? So traits that I have worked with in the past that are QDLs are maize resistance to Aspergillus flavus. So Aspergillus flavus is a fungus. It produces aflatoxin in its host, and aflatoxin is a carcinogen, so we don't want that in our food supply. So as it turned out, it's a quantitative trait, so it's an area of research in the United States. We're trying to look for QDLs. More resistance to Aspergillus flavus in maize. Okay? And another quantitative trait would be rice resistance to bacterial panic of life. So what is this? This is a disease of rice caused by the bacterium Burkholderia glumae. And what it does is it causes about 70% loss in yields. And what you see would be discoloration and grains that are empty. Okay, browning stalks, and usually they're empty. Okay, so it's a big loss. Okay, so those are quantitative traits. So what about transgenic technology? So this is also called genetic engineering technology, and it is justified as the transfer of a gene or a part thereof into the same or another organism. So we do that, we use that in agriculture to introduce traits into a crop that does not have that trait in order to have desirable traits, okay, or desirable body. So in our example of the resistant tomato, we may start with the tomato that's susceptible but high yielding, and if we know the gene for disease resistance, say for example, this is the gene for disease resistance and this is the vector, we can transform the gene into the susceptible tomato in order to create disease resistant tomatoes that are high yielding. Okay, so that's via transgenic technology. Okay, but in order to do that, we need to know the sequence. We need to know the disease resistance gene. We need to know its sequence. Okay? So what about RNA interference? I said earlier that I will tell you a little bit about RNA interference. So it is just, it's also known as gene silencing. It is a mechanism acquired by genomes to ward off virus infection and transposons. Okay, so very briefly, with just go through this diagram that describes it. So what it is you know, if a genome sends a double-stranded DNA, it will target it for destruction because a double-stranded RNA is not normal. Okay, so we have a mechanism here that we use to silence any gene in the genome of the organism or any genome that will be introduced later on. So we take advantage of this property that we discovered a while ago to introduce genes coming from the pathogen. Okay, so if you have genes coming from the pathogen, you and we have kits to introduce an RNA interference system into an organism, we will be able to stop any kind of pathogen or any kind of infection when we introduce part of the pathogen, introduced by an RNAi vector, so that later on when we see this pathogen or even pests infect our organism, there will be a mechanism that will stop the pathogen, right? So that's what RNAi does. It silences whatever it sees that's double-stranded RNA because it's not normal. But in order to do this, again, we need to have gene sequence information. Okay, I think you can see where I'm driving at. Okay, and now, you know, another application of agriculture right now that's big would be optimization of chemical inputs and soil conditions. So right now, all efforts are focused on effects of inputs on yield and not on physiological properties of crops. So, you know, this is an area that we can also look into. If crop physiology is optimum for nutrient absorption, for example, we would only need minimum input, right? So, knowledge of gene sequence for a specific physiological property would be extremely helpful. And I would like to give you this example. This is work by my collaborators from the Louisiana State University. So, these are roots of sweet potato. And we subjected them to different nitrogen levels. So, this one, 0. Here, 20. Here, we have 40 ppm and 80 ppm. So, as it turned out, I think optimum levels of nitrogen absorption would be around between 20 to 40 ppm. Okay, and as you can see, look at the root architecture in these two concentrations. So we hypothesized that if we have root systems that are optimized like this, then we would have optimum absorption of nutrients from the soil, and we will have a minimum chemical input. Okay, and but in order to do this, we would know the genes that are responsible for this kind of architecture, root architecture, correct? Yes? Okay, and what are the characteristics? So that's what we've been doing in agriculture, just our regular agriculture so far, from the beginning until this day. So let me tell you about what's going on in research in genomics right now. So we've been sequencing lots and lots and lots of things. So among these things will be animals, plants, including crops, plant and animal pests, plant and animal pathogens. And at the same time, we're also researching on transcriptomic sequences of different processes, as well as proteomics and metabolomic sequences. Okay, so what's transcriptomics, proteomics, and metabolomics? So these are just all a study of the transcriptome, proteome, and metabolome respectively. Okay, so what they are, so transcriptomics would be total study of gene expression, proteomics would be total study of protein expression, while metabolomics would be study of metabolomics, which is total study of metabolomics at any specific time and any specific life cycle in an organism. Okay, also, and so what else? So these are the crops with completed or partially sequenced genome, okay? And I think the list is increasing. So among them would be these are crops and trees and vegetables and fruits, okay? So we have all this sequence information right now, either completed or partially completed. we have we done? Okay, so in the earlier projects, we used batch libraries and digoxy sequencing method to come up with these sequence genomes. But towards the end, we've started using NGS or next generation sequencing technologies. So when those genomes that were sequenced this way, we used a whole genome shotgun approach. Okay, we did not clone anything, but just sequence the whole genome directly. So this is high throughput, and the data analysis was high throughput as well. And annotation was automated and manual at the same time, because there has to be a manual component all the time. And you know, because these sequencing projects were funded by public, so like the NSF, DOE, NIH, what else, USDA, there is a requirement for all researchers to submit these sequences to public databases. And why? Because you know, these agencies by the government are funded from taxpayer dollars. So they are ready for public use. So whether you use them or not, they are there. But anyway, this data, these sequences, and all these annotations are available from different public bases, databases. And the most popular would be NCBI or GenBank. Okay? So you can search them. You can search NCBI. You can search GenBank and look for the sequence of your favorite organism. Okay, so how do you use this? Now, I told you we have all these sequences. We have all these genomes, either partially or completed. So how can we use them as researchers or maybe as agronomists or as farmers or breeders? Okay, so we have all this data and sequence information available. You can, the very straight one, or the most straightforward way by which you can use them will be as molecular markers, and then using PCR or quantitative PCR in order to locate your genes or loci of interest. So let's go back to the example of QTL that I showed you earlier. So in this example, I told you if we think that this is where the major influential area would be, then we can focus on that area. And if this is a genome that has been sequenced, then we know where to look for, right? Okay, so in this example, let's say that we know that there are two SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphism. And say, for example, that you know, in this sequence here, we know that it is linked to a desirable trait. So for example, so the main difference between these two sequences would be the G and the A here, okay? And say, for example, that SNP1 is desirable while SNP2 is not. So early on, at the seed stage, or at the seedling stage, where the plant is still very young, we can extract DNA, and that's very easy, anybody can do that. And PCR, you can design PCRs from this end, primers from this end and this end, PCR and sequence, and we can already tell if we will continue with that specific seed or with that specific seedling without waiting for the plant to grow into an adult. So that will save us a lot of time and a lot of resources, right? Okay, another application. So, another application would be using reverse genetics. So, reverse genetics is when you have your sequence, but you don't know what it does. Okay, so you're trying to look for the function. So, for example, you have this organism that's round or sort of oblong, that's blue, and which has these triangular projections around it. Okay, and we know its genome sequence, okay? And so we looked at the database, and we looked at all the annotated genes, and, you know, in our research, we're interested in the blue color, for example. For example, the blue color will give a high value to our crop, say it's sweet potato, and say blue sweet potato is very pricey. So that's what we want. Okay, we want this blue color for, so that we can introduce it to sweet potato. So how can we do that? So in this organism here, so we looked at the annotation and this sequence appears to be the sequence for the blue color, but we're not sure because it's just a sequence information and we don't have any functional test to validate it. Okay, so what do we do? So what you do is reverse genetics. So what is reverse genetics? So you mutate a part of the gene, say for example, say maybe sometimes a point mutation will be enough, sometimes you have to delete a big chunk, or sometimes you just have to disrupt the whole gene. It depends on the situation. But for example, just a point mutation is enough, so you disrupt your gene by substituting that gene into a T, so now it's different, it has a mutation, and you put it back into your organism, okay? And look, you lost the blue color, so your original hypothesis was correct, that this gene sequence indeed code for the blue color. And now you're sure that this gene sequence is indeed the sequence for the blue color, and now you're ready to use it for your organism to give it a higher value. Okay? So that's one use. So, in general, known gene sequences may be used as markers, transgenes, or sequences for RNAi sequences. Okay? Okay, so let's talk about crop genomes. So what hindrance in sequencing crop genomes are their sizes. They're very, very huge. But the number of genes are almost the same in all organisms. So, and they are huge because of the presence of repetitive elements. So the difference in the sizes of genomes are just really because of repetitive elements. And another problem with crops would be polyploidy. They are very notorious for polyploidy. Okay? But there is a solution. We can use synteny, okay, or gene order. So this is an example of synteny. Okay? So in this diagram, we have rice, red, and then maize, yellow, and wheat, blue-green. Okay? And as you all know, rice, maize, and wheat belong to the same family. They're all cereal family or grass family. So what, how, you know, and we know we have the rice sequence right now. It's well annotated. We also have the maize genome sequence, but it is not as advanced as the rice genome sequence and annotation. So what we can use, if we're interested in specific characteristics like height, we can look at where it is in rice, and you know, we can design primers in rice, but use maize as a template, okay? And we may be able to fish out our gene of interest using that way because of synteny. Correct? Does it make sense? Okay. And here is another application, okay? So this would be the 12 chromosomes of rice. So they are the gray bars. And these are the 10 chromosomes of maize. So as it turns out, this is how the chromosomes line up. So if you're interested in this gene in maize, for example, you will use the same procedure. You know that it aligns to this region in rice. So you design primers in rice using maize as the template. Okay, and this kind of information is available whether you go to the maize database system or rice genome annotation system. You will be able to find this information, and they are also published. There are publications that describe these kinds of studies. Okay, so now sequencing of crop genomes. We said that the greatest challenge would be the genome size. Another alternative is just sequencing the exome, which is the expressed part of the genome. So, and anyway, then you don't really need to worry about the repetitive element parts. So you can just concentrate on the exosomes, and so you just need all genes. And then you may also use Symphony to study main genomes using the genes of a smaller genome. But you have to keep in mind that Symphony will only work or is more reliable if you're dealing with a family. So usually it happens in the same family, okay? But you may also use resources such as FACS to search for your gene of interest. And this is what we use when we did our study in Loblolly Pines, okay? So we were interested in a few genes in Loblolly Pines, and this would be genes that may be important in bioenergy. So we targeted genes that would be implicated in cell wall synthesis, transcription factors, and as an added gene, we also looked at disease resistance. So we generated a back library resource for Loblolly Pines. So we have that resource, and you may not have that in your organism of interest, but since we had it, we screened the library. We screened the back library using those genes that I just showed you earlier. And this is the step that we, so after screening, so we were able to isolate 15 bags that contain our genes of our interest, okay? So we analyzed those sequences and we annotated them for the genes that we were interested in. And so the first thing else, and so bags are also long. I mean, they are not as long as genomes, but they are, the bags that we generated were about 120 AB size, okay? And usually genes would be 5 AB, 7 AB, 80, or even less, right? So it's still a short piece of what we want in a large sea of something else that we don't want, right? So most of these things that we didn't want were also repeat. So even if you have targeted your search in a specific region, in a specific fragment, your genes will still be short and the rest will still be repetitive elements. It happens all the time. And so using this strategy, we had our back sequence. We masked the repeats using repeat master, and as a consequence, we were able to remove, or not really remove, but single out all the repeats. And we found out that retrotransposons are still the most abundant repeats in the fine genome. And that's not really surprising. And then we use these gene annotators in order to annotate for the genes that we were looking for. So we use BLAST. BLAST is a homology-based search engine. I think you have, most of you have used it, right? Who among you have used BLAST in the past? Okay, so you're familiar with it. So it's homology-based. And then we use FGNESH, Augustus, GeneMark to predict the genes, and Artemis to view the prediction. So these three different gene predictors are up initial gene predictors, meaning they start from nothing. And then just look for genes depending on what you tell them to be genes. So we have a few ESTs and cDNAs from previous research. So, and these all came from Vine. Of course, they have come from Vine. And so we told these gene predictors that these are the genes in Vine. Go look for genes that would follow this template. Okay, basically that's what we told these predictors. And, okay, so I told you we have 50 bags. And we were able to annotate 140 gene models out of the 50. Okay? But, unfortunately, 105 were slow genes, and only 9 were predicted genes. So you know that that's a low input, but you know what can you do? That's what came out from the screening. Okay. So how can you tell? Okay. So we have 114 gene models. How can you tell low genes, what would be an indicator? Anybody? Can anybody tell me? Okay. It's okay, you can guess. It can be wrong. You know, if you see a stop codon, premature stop codon in the middle of an exon, that is an indication that it's a slow gene, that it's probably functional in the past, but something happened, mutation, probably, that rendered it to be a slow gene. So we saw a lot of that in the fine genome. And that might be something that you will always see in an old genome. Fine is an old genome, by the way. Okay, so keep that in mind if you're doing a sequencing project or a gene search project. Okay, so this is the summary of the gene models that we knocked out. So these all, the first eight, were all related to cell wall synthesis. And so that was good. And the last one is a transcription factor. So in summary, look at how varied the models are. So here it looks like a regular gene, but pretty short. Just a little over 1 AB. So it's this one. But look at this last one here. That's about 12 AB. So we saw all kinds of variation in the genes that we search. Okay? And look at this one. Now we thought, this is kind of unusual. And when we first saw it, we thought, is this real? But how else can we say? I mean, we had no way of knowing whether it was real or not until we do a functional analysis. Okay, so we will just stand by with this result for now. Okay, and this one is a transcription factor. Okay, so that's how you can use gene sequence information to search for genes in crops, to search for valuable genes in crops. Okay, so and that's also looking for just actual genes without looking at the function yet, or if there is a prior information on the function, or if you've done a functional test to test it. Okay, so what about if you're looking for gene expression? You can also do that. So, as I told you earlier, we have sequences of our pathogen and pests available to us. So, what can we use them for? And actually, we can use them to provide clues on pathogenicity, virulence or infectivity, and this can assist us in breeding programs on what to select. And using this information, we may be able to use them for transgenic and RNAi technologies, right, or techniques. And what about researchers from transcriptomics, proteomics, or metabolomics? So this will allow us a better understanding of the biology of an organism. Again, you know, this is important when you're trying to eradicate a pest or eradicate a pathogen. You want to know what's going on, right, in the biology of the system. And again, this may assist us in breeding programs and to select under a specific condition, say under a condition that is this susceptible or under stress or under drought or any other combination of all these things that you may think about. And again, this will give us additional information on gene and protein expression and in an identifying mechanism associated with a process for an organism. Okay? So I would like to give you an example of something that we did, research that we did that applied these principles that I just told you. So this was a research on bacterial chronicle blight. So as I told you, it is a disease of rice caused by a bacterium, and this is how a healthy rice plant, mature rice plant looks like. The grains are stooping down because of heaviness, and if you have empty grains, they are just straight. Okay? So just a few primer on the pathogen. It is called Bordetella rumei, and it was first observed in Asia in the 50s, and now it also in the United States, beginning in the late 90s. And it's aggravated by hot and humid conditions, and it may cause up to 70% of yield loss. And right now, we don't know any source of resistance, and we have no idea about the disease cycle and pathogen. So we designed this experiment to look for sources of resistance. So I will just walk you through this diagram. So this is a resistant seedling or moderately resistant genotype, while this is a susceptible genotype. So we inoculated both of them, so they both got the same treatment, exactly the same. So water, which was the control, and the pathogen inoculated. And we sampled after 48 hours, and we collected total RNA. Okay, and our intention was to sequence this total RNA that we collected from rice or infected rice and look at total gene expression. Okay, so we looked at total gene expression and we compared gene expression quantitatively between the host transcriptome coming from the resistant plant and the host transcriptome coming from the susceptible plant. So it was a comparative analysis. Okay, and we found out that no resistant, I mean, if you follow rice research, you know that rice disease resistance is well studied. Because it's prone to blight and blast. So blight is caused by Magbanua briseae, and blight is called by is caused by Pseudomonas. Santibonus. So we found out, so we have resistance genes against the pathogens, well known and well studied. But we found out that these no resistance genes were not present or were not differentially expressed in our system. So it's entirely different kind of disease. Okay, and so we saw that we hypothesized that different kinds of defense response might be involved in this disease. Okay, so another finding was we saw a part of an possibly a DNA element that's called PIF, or P stability factor, is a DNA element, and so we saw a part of it that so probably. We think that it's a DNA binding protein, and so we found upregulated expression of this protein in our inoculated resistance. So, in addition, we saw so MPS LRR resistance genes are the resistance genes that we have. cloned from different plants. So if you talk about resistance genes in plants, you talk about MPS-LRR, and this is well known. And this family of genes are ancient. They're involved in pathogen recognition. So they are the receptors. They are present in large numbers and occurs in clusters. But a lot of them are pseudogenes due to illegitimate combination because they occur in clusters. And they're usually negatively regulated. And we have, they are activated by ATP. So in order to activate them, you need ATP, okay? And so in our results, when we did gene ontology analysis of the upregulated transcripts from our results, okay, so I will just explain this diagram to you. Anything that is solid bar would be coming from upregulated resistance over susceptible. Okay? And anything that's striped would be upregulated in the susceptible over the resistant. Okay? And this would be how we would differentiate the different functions. So anything that's red would be a biological response. Anything that's blue would be a molecular function. And green would be a component of the cell. So as it turned out, we did not see any difference in biological process between the inoculated susceptible and inoculated resistant. And the same also with cell component. We did not see much difference. But if you see molecular function, in the there is upregulation of ATP binding in the resistant over the susceptible. So this is something that we did not see in the upregulation in the susceptible. So that's one difference. So to summarize, not much difference there. So we saw MPS LRR genes both expressed in the resistant and susceptible. So this would be the genes that are involved in defense, or programmed cell death. So there's not much difference in the in just the genes. But it turned out that it is really a part of the pathway that was missing in the susceptible line. So the activation was in by ATP was the component that's missing in the susceptible line, and not just the presence of the gene. Okay? And we also did some QRD PCR validation of these genes, and the take-home message from this graphs would be we found out that the resistance mechanism that we saw that were upregulated in the resistant genotype were already expressed in the water control. Okay, so we have constitutive expression of these resistance-related genes in the resistant genotype as compared to the susceptible genotype. We did not see this constitutive expression in the susceptible genotype. Okay, and so to conclude our study, we say that no resistance genes against rice, blast, and bacterial type are not expressed in the resistant genotype, some not even in the water control. And transcripts involved in pathogen resistance are constitutively expressed in the resistant genotype, and they include activation partners and other downstream components of the resistance pathway. And a one score of a transposable element appears to have been co-opted as a defense arsenal by the resistant genotype. And resistance may have existed prior to rice domestication. I did not explain this very well because I don't have enough time. Okay, so that's how we use genomics and transcriptomics and all of this data in our experiment. And this is just an example that I want to show you that you can do anything, you can use anything in the databases for whatever use you may have in your experiment. You don't even need to generate your own data. You can use whatever is available out there that's publicly, you know, that it's free for the public. Okay? And so, you know, the ultimately, this is the objective. We have public databases that we will be able to access to our cell phones, our tablets, our laptops, etc. And so we have all this information there, and we will be able to access them wherever we are. And farmers, breeders, and scientists will be able to get all of this information at the click, you know, click of the phone or iPad. And we can find details on how to grow, care, select for a genotype of a crop on a specific environment under specific set of conditions to grow it really optimally. And at this point, I would like to acknowledge the University of the Philippines, NIMH, which is my host for this Balikbayan stint, and the Department of Science and Technology, specifically Fisher, and my collaborators in the researches that I have mentioned to you, these people. Again, my local host, Dr. Lowe. And I thank everybody for your time and attention. And now I'm ready to address questions that you may have. Thank you.
That indeed a very good picture of how genome comes in as very, really, how genome would increase the improvement or rapidly improve our crops. So rapid, efficient, and in a very targeted system. So the floor is open for questions. Anybody?
Don't be shy. It's all right.
Very good characteristic.
Filipino students,
I guess the Western students. Yes.
That was questions.
We would like to recognize the presence Dr. Cadiz, the head of the Knowledge Management Office of SEARCA. Any questions?
Really, you have the questions?
Maybe what would be very interesting is the last part on how you have predicted the genes in lovely minds.
Yeah.
That would be very interesting. Forest genomics.
Yeah. Well, I took out a lot of parts to explain how we did it in the interest of time. But yeah, it's a long, tedious process. So we had to create the back library. Which took several years. I think it took about 3 years to construct that resource. And then, you know, we had to create what we call high-density filters. So once we have the back library, we transferred the clones into membranes. And we screen them on the membranes because you cannot work with actual clones when you are screening. So it's just like a regular southern type of experiment, that except that it's high throughput. So we screened a equivalent of 3x of the library, and so we were able to identify bags that contain our probes or genes of interest. And so we identified the bags and isolated them and sequence. So, you know, this is really, our gene search should have been easier because we searched for the gene. So we knew, or at least ideally or theoretically, we had the genes in those bags, right? But some of them did not have it, so some came out to be false positives. But, you know, I think the problem with the fine genome was that the presence of lots of pseudogenes. Because, so we would only select one per probe. We did not have money to sequence more than one per probe. And so it turned out that what we selected contained pseudogenes. So, you know, it was not very efficient. But that was, we couldn't think of it, that was the only way. I mean, you could have done PCR, but we have no idea about gene sequence. And we will not get the whole thing. You know, PCR, you can only PCR, I don't know, 500 base pair, 7 at the most. Usually when you design a PCR experiment, you don't want something that's very long because, you know, if it becomes longer, it's hard to polymerize. So yeah, so PCR is not really a good option. So when we identified those bags, we were disappointed that 109 were pseudogenes. More pseudogenes than predicted genes. Yeah. But what can you do? That's the way the genome was. Because, you know, it's old. So we found out that it's not really a surprise that it's mostly redundant bosons. But what we also found out was because of its old age, a lot of the redundant bosons also diverge from each other. That a lot of them behave like blow copy. But in, you know, at the beginning of transposition, they were all the same. But because of old age and, you know, evolutionary time, they diverge. That now they're behaving like individual or blow copy elements. But as you know, when they first transpose, they really belong to one group or one family. So yeah, you know, when you do these kinds of experiments, you need to be familiar with your organism. Anybody else? Yes.
In your disease resistance study, were you able to identify the specific gene which is responsible, which is related to ADP? Something that you said is related to ADP, and were you able to validate it by screening disease-resistant plants and non-resistant or susceptible, whether it is present or not.
Okay, good question. So, first of all the results that we've seen so far indicate that it's a QTL. So, it may be that there's not a single gene that's significant for resistance, but several genes or several loci. But having said that, yeah, we have some candidates. I have selected a few that seem really interesting and maybe significant because of the value, because of the value of the number of reads. But we're not there yet. We're that's going to be the next goal, to do validation, either through functional analysis or maybe transgenics or RNA guide.
Any other question? Yes, Dr. Magbanua.
Actually, my question is support for the genetic diversity, you know, because one of our colleagues in the College of Forestry performed a genetic diversity assessment on Megan Pine, and she used PSDSSR markers. So I helped her analyze the data, and my concern is she used PSDSSR prone rise markers, and she use that for pines. So you know that pines is ancient, older yung kanyang genome. So I was wondering, because when it comes to genetic diversity assessment, the markers at the species should be developed, okay, to be amplified using at least closely related species. So that's one of my questions. But when I looked at the values of diversities, It did not affect the value, still considerably high. So actually, she told me that if I can ask that particular question, so her intention is to actually do whether these ESTs, the SSRs derived from ESTs, possibly from rice markers, might have something to do with the amplification. You can actually cross-amplify. You can be cross-amplified in Bing and Pine. So that's one.
I'm amazed. If it were my experiment, I wouldn't do it because there are some ESTs of a closer organism. Like there are a lot of ESTs from Pine, from the bloody Pine. Mm-hmm. And if I were to do it, that's what I would use those, not from rice. But surprisingly, she got good results.
Yes, and also, one of the objectives of her project is not only to assess diversity, but to actually find out which particular the population really, whether it came from this population. So actually it's a seed production area, but the origin of the individuals are unknown. So the objective is to really locate where these individuals possibly came from. And using, of course, genetic distances and other clustering analysis, we found out that we can actually, you know, it's like discriminant, we can actually see. So that's why I was really surprised.
I think she should publish the paper. It should be made
We already prepared the paper.
Oh yeah, because it should be made known.
But I was actually searching for some related studies, and no one actually.
That's why you need to publish it. Yeah, because as I told you, that's not what I would do. But if I see a precedence, if I see a publication that did it and it was successful, then I think you will help a lot of researchers. because we don't have a lot of resources for a lot of crops.
Because she actually did the experiments through in a form of collaboration. That time, the available markers are from SSR, EST, SSRs. So now, the paper was already drafted a year ago, but I'm worried.
You should submit it. Yes, sir.
Hi, Mom. For the sake of the two,
yes.
For the sake of the two computational science panel here in the audience, can you tell us what type of computational resources you used for all of these things?
Yes. We use the resources of IGBB and HPC squared. And so at Mississippi State, we have high performance computing facilities. And so it's a whole building of just computers. That's what it is. So that's what we use. So, but you know, it depends. We are not the only user. We have a whole building of computers. That's why we have this facility. This is, you know, the main user of this facility would be at engineering. Mississippi State is also an engineering school, and it's a university, so it has all courses. So engineering is one of the major uses of this facility. But since we biologists can use those facilities too. But in your case, if you don't have such facility, you may be able to use your laptop, but it will be slow. If you have so many data coming from a genome sequence, it may not be enough. But there is an alternative, because at the PGC we have a high computing facility, and we are willing to help you. We will help you with all your computations and with the design of your experiments. We have sequencers, we have Illumina sequencers. So we have all these resources available to the community, to all of us. So make use of them. We have a MySeq. We will have a NextGen 500 pretty soon, and by the end of the year, we will have an iSeq 2500. And we have some bioinformaticians who can help us too. So don't let that deter you from doing this experiment. We have resources, and we can make do with what we have. Or, you know, if you really want to, I can hook you up to my collaborators at Mississippi State if you really want something huge, something big. But, you know, it's not as straightforward as using the facilities we have at PGC. Okay? Thank you, Jay.
Okay. So thank you for offering that up. But right now, PGC Agriculture here in UPL is collaborating with the crop bioinformatics group, to develop our, to train our researchers on bioinformatics and in analyzing the genome sequence data that's probably generated.
So we have the resources
Yes.
Okay, so we do have it.
But not actually, not yet. We are starting up building one. We have our data center, we have with us Prof. Arian Hasildo, who is working closely with us and helping us develop that. Yes. So it actually is an Institute of Computer Science in collaboration with the crop bioinformatics of India.
That's good. And maybe Dr. Jadrick can help us too.
Yes.
Right, Jadrick?
Okay, so if there are no more questions, we would like to award a token from SEARCA, and at this point maybe call on Dr. Maria Salet, Cali's program head of knowledge management and the former dean of the College of Development Communication of UPLD. Thank you very much for coming. Hope to see you again in the next.